Hello, Married with Children podcast listeners. Before we get to today's show, we wanted to offer congratulations to our very own co-host, Annabelle Whitford, on her marriage to William Miller this Saturday, April 17th, 2021. As you all know, Annabelle is the world's one and only married ANIAC and our queen of Married with Children facts and trivia. As she walks the last mile this weekend to finally live out her Married with Children fandom to its fullest, we wish her and William a lifetime of health, wealth, and happiness together. The only unfortunate thing about being Mrs. Miller is that from now on Halloween, she will be egging her own house. On Saturday, myself and all the Married with Children podcast co-hosts will be lifting Bundy mimosas in her honor from across the Pacific as they dance We've Only Just Begun Together. Congratulations, Annabelle and William.
Annabelle, this is Steven, and I just want to wish you and your fiancé the best marriage possible. I hope it has longevity. I hope it has a great future. And I just want to wish you guys the best.
Hey, Annabelle, this is your friend Chris from Houston, Texas. Heard the news and just wanted to say congratulations on your upcoming wedding. I hope things go better than Al and Peg's wedding did, and I really hope things go better than Marcy and Jefferson's wedding. Who am I kidding? I don't think you have anything to worry about there. But no, on a serious note, I just wanted to say congratulations again, and I wish you both many years of love and happiness, and I hope all your dreams come true. And I also wanted to say thank you so much for everything that you've given to Married with Children fandom over the last 20 to 25 years. Believe me, it doesn't go unnoticed, and we're all very thankful for it. Again, congratulations, and I wish you nothing but the best.
Hello, listeners, and anybody who's tuning in to hear this, because this is Tyler Tigno, and I have a special message dedicated to the great and wonderful Annabelle and her soon-to-be, possibly hearing this, already husband, William Miller. Woo! Yeah!
Get it!
Woo! Seriously, Annabelle, William, I am so happy for you. Annabelle, you already know me. William, hi. My name is Tyler. Awesome American, Married with Children podcast person here. And I just wanted to wish you guys the best. I literally just got finished doing an awesome recording with your soon-to-be or already awesome wife and wished her, you know, the best. But this is going to be an official wish. And I'm just so happy for you guys. It's such a wonderful time to have a union at any time, especially now. I mean, we do a podcast called Married with Children. There's no children yet, but married. And the intro to that wonderful television show is Love and Marriage. And you know what? We make jokes. We talk cynical stuff about, you know, marriage and wives and husbands, but deep down we all respect it and we all love and celebrate when a union happens. And for you guys, applause right here, right now, for Annabelle and William. I wish I could be there. In a perfect world, I could totally hop a plane and just fly right out there. But unfortunately, I can't, so I'm just sending you all my love in spirit. Right here from Michigan, Motown itself, in the metro area, Tyler's wishing you one hell of a rockin' Crocodile Dundee-ish, gotta throw in an Australian thing somewhere, wedding. Y'all have a wonderful time, and someday we'll all celebrate as a group. Okay. You guys have a great time. Bye.
To Annabelle, aka Married ANIAC, aka Bundiana, I wish you and your new husband William many, many years of happily wedded bliss and many, many good years ahead. You are two amazing people. It's an honor to have you both in my life, and I wish you very well. What more can I say? So happy for you guys. Congratulations. Well, marriage.
Annabelle, this is Al. Just want to say congratulations to you and William. I hope you have a very happy marriage, and who knows what you'll get after 16 years. You know, like 16 years, and what do you get? You know, I guess we'll find out in 16 years. Right. Well, congratulations.
Worthless than yours.
Well, how could that possibly be? Well, what about the commercial?
There's not gonna be a commercial.
Why?
I've got a zit!
Let's rock.
Thanks, Dad.
Can I get a whoopin'?
Whoa!
No Man presents, live from the Nudie Bar, the Married with Children podcast.
Welcome back to the podcast, Married with Children listeners. It is season 9 in the great year of 2021. My name is Tyler, and I've just got finished getting into slap fights with Shannon Dodery and having my ass grabbed by Bob Barker.
Well, I'm Steven, and I guess it's just me and Buck now. Because if you're having dreams like that, I don't know if I want to work with you anymore. are you gonna sue Bob Barker now for that?
Can I sue him if I liked it?
I don't know. That's a good question. You see, we're trying to entertain you more than this episode we're going to be reviewing. Anyway, yeah. This is season 9, episode 3. Director Jerry Cohen. Writers are Larry Jacobson and Michael Moy. It aired on September 18th, 1994.
Special guest stars include Michael Francis Clark as the stage manager, Cleto Augusto as director, Dennis Boone as Chinese actor, Don Bruno II as cameraman number one, and Dot Marie Jones as Lola. She was a showgirl. Oh, I'm kidding.
Mm-hmm, that's right. And the title of this episode is Kelly Breaks Out, which is a pun, capital P-U-N, pun on the fact that Kelly has an acne breakout and doesn't get her acting break. We get to talking about a great... good, maybe not so good episode of Married with Children. What are you thinking, Steven?
You're ruining it for everybody.
I could be trolling them. Maybe it's not. Maybe it's awesome. No, it's not.
For years, Kelly Bundy's been one of TV's most beautiful women.
Babe, your butt looks bitchin'.
But this Sunday, she's getting a new look. So shocking, so horrifying.
Wow!
You've got to see it to believe it.
Great Caesar's ghost!
Catch Kelly's new look on an all-new Married with Children Sunday.
But... Well, it's probably more of a double play because this was supposed to be her breakout role, you know, getting in this commercial that I don't want to reveal too much yet.
But it's, you know, not so it's her breakout role. She's already been in a music video. She's already been a Weenie Tots girl. She's already been a model. She's been in Verminator. Like, yeah, those are all like blah, but it's hardly her breakout role as this weird beer commercial. This is like a season 3 or 4 kind of thing.
Oh, maybe.
Thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? It's kind of a sad thing where she's like, oh my God, I want to be in this commercial. Like, it fits for Kelly, but it also doesn't fit for the character development. It's like they backtracked.
Maybe. It's just very unimaginative, and maybe we ought to get into the episode now so we can get this over with.
Without further ado, let's get into Season 9, Episode 3, Kelly Breaks Out. We begin this episode with usually one of my favorite scenes, Al and Jefferson on the couch watching TV.
Boy, what's the matter with sitcoms these days? Where's the new Arnold the Pigs? The new Barney Fifes? Where's the Grady's from Sanford and Son?
Take this guy. All he's done for the last 20 minutes is talk about which toothbrush is his.
Yeah, like a real man would use a toothbrush. See what else is up. Oh, now this looks good. This is the new Barnaby Jones reunion show.
Dad, that's the new Rolling Stones video. That's not Buddy Ibsen, that's Keith Richards.
I thought he looked a little old for Buddy Ibsen. Ah, the Home Shopping Network. Boy, this is a good idea for women. It was a little too tough driving to the mall with a couch strapped to their ass.
Which reminds me, Peggy's still in Wanker County, right?
Yeah, but not for long. Not since the doctor put her mom on a no-salt lick diet. She should be back on all fours any minute now.
That's good. Oh, look. White trash collector plates.
I'm glad Peg's not here to see this.
Our first call is from Wanker County, Wisconsin. Yes, I'd like to order the Roger Clinton service for 8, please. Now, that comes with matching spittoons, right?
You know, it's amazing. They don't even have gravity in Wanker County, but they get the Home Shopping Network.
Yes, and I'd also like the Galooly soup tureens.
And we go into my first complaint, Stephen. So this episode is so filled with pop culture references that I don't think anybody now under the age of 40, I'm sorry, Stephen, will get at all.
Oh, I would totally agree with you on that. I would totally agree with you because, oh, man, Barnaby Jones, I hadn't thought about that in a long time.
I've never thought about that because I have no idea what that is. But yeah, all these names, and I'll just list them off right now that I'm remembering these names. I'm not looking at the notes right now. These are the names I remembered. Barney Fife, Barnaby, whatever that last name is, Emily Peel. Then there's like, what was it? Like Bill Robbie Clinton, Buddy Ibsen, Arnold the Pig, yeah.
Yeah.
Roger Clinton Jr., which was a person I didn't know existed, but I guess I should have. Tanya Harding, I recognize that name.
Yeah.
I don't know who she is, but I didn't. And I recognize the name Jeff Galooly, but again, don't know who these people are, and they act like they do.
But, you know, they also mentioned Grady Wilson, another recurring character. And all of these that are mentioned are sidekicks. Did you notice that?
No, I did not. I was trying to follow along with the way they were describing it because they're like, we don't have to talk about this. Everyone who's watching this knows about Grady Wilson and all these side characters. And I'm like, what? Mm-hmm. And then this whole weird The Avengers.
Yeah.
Original tapes of the British TV series, The Avengers.
That butt. I'd know that butt anywhere. That's Emma Peel. Those are Peel cheeks. Peel, 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 Peel. You know, Emma Peel's the one that wore the really tight jumpsuit.
And kicked really high.
Thereby allowing us to see every single nuance and fold in her body. Jefferson, I've got to order this.
To the phones. Has it occurred to either of you rutabagas that the woman may be pushing 200 by now? Pounds and years?
That's why you look at them on tape. If I only had a look at your mother on tape, I'd still be having sex with her.
I thought they made this up, Stephen. Like the Avengers thing.
Yeah, because when we think of the Avengers now, it's Captain America, Thor, and Iron Man.
We'll talk about it when we get to the end of the episode, but when the episode ends, it ends with, again, I thought they made it up, the sound of something that they're watching, which is apparently the theme song to this Avengers thing, possibly. And it's like, okay, thank you. Like, she's must be over 100 and she can still kick. And I'm like, oh, is that Emma Peel?
Yeah, it's a vague reference to Emma Peel, but we're kind of getting ahead of ourselves.
Okay, yeah.
You know, because
I just wanted to throw it all out there because they litter this episode filled with weird names and pop culture references that I don't think we're going to be able to cover them all. So, listeners, if you haven't watched this episode first and you're listening to us first, pop it in and check it out. And I guarantee you, you're going to be whipping out your iPhone or your tablet every 10 seconds going, who?
A little sidebar of a note. I believe that it was in production at the time. There was an Avengers movie coming out that revolved around the Avengers characters from the old 1960s television series starring Emma Peel. It was coming out in the 90s, and it has one of the worst ratings on Rotten Tomatoes and Internet Movie Database.
Oh, dear. Was this like a made-for-TV movie kind
of
thing?
No, it was a theatrical thing. I thought of going to see it because I do remember that show a little bit, but when I heard all the reviews, I thought, oh, to hell with that. I'm not going to go watch it.
You know what? Maybe you and me will watch it one time, and we'll do a little review our own, maybe a handwritten review or something.
Well, remember what I said a minute ago? I guess it's just me and Buck. Yeah, well, if I could call a cab, it'll just be you.
No.
No offense. I will not watch that.
Fine, listeners, I'll watch it. But until then, what we were watching, though, was Married with Children, Season 9, Episode 3, Kelly Breaks Out. And Al and Jefferson are watching this weird show. So even though I'm hosting right now, Stephen, can you explain to me what exactly Al's, like, plot is for this episode? What is he trying to get? Because I'm still not 100% sure.
Well, he's trying to get a copy of The Avengers with Emma Peel.
Is he trying to get a copy of the video, or is he trying to get, like, a commemorative plate?
No, he's just getting a video, because remember, Jefferson walks in later with that video.
Okay, so it's a video with her on the cover? How is this particular video different than another video?
No, that's it. You know, I really don't know. This plot is like one of the most ridiculous pieces of bullshit I've heard, even for a Married with Children episode. I mean, take out that part and just focus on Kelly. I think Married with Children is at a point now where they feel like they have to have a B plot. They have to have the B plot. And the B plot isn't always necessary if you have a good A plot.
That's true, but that, you know, The Simpsons were doing that on this time, and I do think The Simpsons' success on Fox kind of curtailed a lot of the writing movements at this time, and I think it was the whole idea is you need a beginning A plot that may mean nothing to the bigger B plot, and then sooner or later those two plots intertwine, or at least come together at the end. Sometimes strongly, sometimes loosely. But you're right. Like, you should have just dropped it. But I will give an alternate to this. Married with Children, one of the reasons I love it, is very good at doing very obscure, very weird things. Like they could have done something with this. Just have Al trying to get a copy of this video, just this video, period. And I don't know, like about a specific episode, and the whole thing is him trying to meet this, and he meets a bunch of weird people, or maybe get one of those actors from that weird British television show as a guest and have them be a sadistic psycho and torture Al. That's something Married with Children would have done. Yeah.
Right now we're in the Looney Tunes phase, that you like to call it. And you might remember in season 4, we had Desperately Seeking Miss October. You know, that was the plot. There was no B plot there.
It was great.
Yeah. And that's what made Married with Children good, is having a good plot. You don't necessarily need a B story. Now, sometimes it works in well. We're going to be looking at Dial B for Virgin. within the next few weeks. And that
Steve is so excited about this episode.
Oh, yeah, it's one of my all-time favorites. I love Miss Hardaway. She is hilarious. I don't have a crush on her, but I think she is hilarious. But the thing is, there was a good B plot in that one. What was it when it was in season six, Teacher's Pets. Bud was getting it on with his teacher, and Al was eating. He was eating, going to Chuck E. Cheese's to all the birthday parties. That was a good B plot. This one has no A plot, no B plot. It's a bunch of crap. Okay.
It's an episode about Kelly, but you need to have something else happening because this whole plot with Kelly is going to be very strange. Because if you want to focus on Kelly, which is what they're going to do, they're going to focus on Kelly's story. That's going to be the main thing. Mm-hmm. Then you can't make your smaller plot that convoluted. Like you and me, we can't even figure out exactly what Al's beef is. Like, yeah, we know he's trying to get something. I'm spending time trying to figure that out. And then Kelly saunters in, and I'm just kind of like, okay, we'll go back to Al in a minute, I guess. But Kelly comes on in, looking fine. I mean, fine. Like, Christina Applegate is looking really, really good. I think she's finally found herself.
Can I have $200?
No, you can't, Pumpkin. We have to save everything we have for the essentials. You know, food, clothing. Hello. Yes, I'd like to order the new Emma Peel tape, please. Do you have one where she kicks really high?
Bud?
Do I look like I'm made of money?
Well, just that roll of dimes you keep in your pants.
Those are quarters. I mean... I don't know what you're talking about.
Please, it's only $200.
Kelly, I work at the Department of Vehicle Services. How much money do you think I make riding around in a car all day? And remember, I'm upright and in the front seat.
Please, I need to help me get a beer commercial.
Budweiser?
No, Ice Hole.
Just asking, slut.
Ice Hole is the name of the beer. It's one of those new microbrewery beers, and they're having auditions for spokesmodels in a couple days. I mean, this could be the biggest thing in my life. I mean, before you know it, I'll be living it up in Hollywood, getting in slap fights with Shannon Doherty and having my ass grabbed by Bob Barker.
Yeah, do you have one where she's soaking wet? Or one where she's... Freezing cold? Huh? Why, yes, I do sell women's shoes. How do you know?
The picture's only $300, and I only have $100.
You have $100?
Yes.
Well, I know a place where you might be able to get your pictures done for $100.
Yeah, me too, but I don't want to be in Jugs magazine.
Okay. Well, I know another place. You know, I just might be able to help you out.
Well, okay. But remember, these have to be the kind of pictures that bring out my best.
And smile.
And I will say, I thought there were a few funny jokes in here. I was laughing out loud. Ice Hole beer.
Yeah, I laughed at that. Like, it's just a syllable away from asshole. So, yeah it's,
that might it's, be a... That might be a reference to an old Michael Keaton movie called Johnny Dangerously. I don't know if you've ever seen that. It's with Mary Lou Henner, one of my favorite babes of all time. But there's a guy in there, and he keeps calling everyone. He has a weird accent, so instead of calling them assholes, he calls them ice holes. And he doesn't call them assholes. He calls them Fargan ice holes.
Fargan ice holes.
Of course,
yeah.
They ran that joke. But I'm thinking maybe that's where they got this idea. I don't know.
You know what? It possibly is. Again, there was some behind the scenes to this episode of why it is structured this way. I would really like to know. But yes, in one of my notes, I have Kelly talking about how she can make her money, because that's when I really started taking notes. And I wrote, I don't want to be in Jugs magazine. And I'm like, oh, damn, why not? Oh, but no, apparently it's, okay, explain this to me. So Bud is offering to take the pictures of Kelly for the commercial audition.
Yeah.
And he's using the DMV camera to take pictures.
But in Oklahoma and Texas, and actually this is phasing out, we have tag agencies that take your pictures. You know,
oh,
you go
really?
To the Department of Safety and take, we call it the Department of Safety here. People call it the DMV. It's wrong in Oklahoma and Texas, Department of Safety. You take your driving test there and your permit test there. Then you go to a tag agency, and they're the ones who make your license. They're regulated by the state.
So. Ooh, it's very boring. It's all in-house and very inefficient here in Michigan. It's called the Secretary of State. They handle all that crap, and it's one building. You go in, you fill out your application there, then you go and stand in line to have that application approved, and then you go stand in line again and, like, take two steps to your right and take a picture, and they do it all there.
Really? And then also, you know, in regards to that, you know, I think it's just an old joke that, you know, it takes forever to get through with licenses. You know? So this is an old running joke throughout, not just Married with Children, but a lot of TV shows.
I just wanted to bring up the DMV thing because I made a note, again, of where Married with Children fails, where they should have succeeded. Married with Children loves to get a lot of extras, and that's a big compliment to me. There's like 25 weird and random looking people in this line at the DMV, and it's just for a panning shot of them all looking disgruntled, and that's over.
Yeah.
Why aren't people yelling? Why aren't colorful rubes making jokes and stuff? That's one of the things I love about Married with Children, is they don't spare expenses on getting just weird extra people to build the world up.
That was a wasted opportunity on their part. Then you find out, first of all, that, you know, in the next scene, that's when we find out, one, they didn't, Jefferson and Al didn't get the right video or something. I forget what it was, or it was another.
It wasn't Emma Peel.
Yeah, that's right. It wasn't Emma Peel.
I think.
This is how forgettable this episode was.
That's not going to affect the mail, is it? Because I'm expecting my Emma Peel tape today. Did I tell you she could kick really, really high?
Daddy. Daddy, I got the commercial. I'm the new Ice Hole girl. Isn't that exciting?
Sure. Sweetheart, did you see the mailman out there?
Daddy, this could be my big break. Aren't you even going to be excited?
Well, honey, yes, I'm excited for you. But you know me. I don't get all gushy and emotional.
The tape's here.
Second, Jefferson, this isn't an Emma Peel Avengers. This is a Linda we couldn't get anybody else to do the show Thorson Avengers. Jefferson, we've been hornswoggled.
To the phones.
Anyway, so it doesn't have Emma Peel. And I thought a slightly good joke when they decide to go to the phones and dial up the company. And Al wants to know, okay, who regulates you guys? Absolutely no one. He writes that down. Now that was lame. 1-800 bite me. Gotcha. Yeah, right. So yeah, a couple of lame jokes in there. And then that's when Kelly reveals her dilemma.
Daddy, I'm ruined. My life is even more worthless than yours.
Well, how could that possibly be? Well, what about the commercial?
There's not gonna be a commercial.
Why?
I've got a zit!
The dilemma is that she can't do the commercial because she's got a zit. Right?
Yes.
Okay, good. Like, and listeners, if this sounds like we're not preparing well for these episodes, me and Steven literally, before we hit record, did a Hulu watch party where we watched it simultaneously, and we're having trouble recalling this stuff. Like, this is bad.
Yeah.
But yes, Kelly's got a big old target right on her forehead. You know what? it's actually a pretty good zit. I will give them credit for that. Like, I would be like, whoa, if I saw a zit
like that
in someone's
thing.
Face.
You know, and girls have this advantage. You know, it's right in the middle of her forehead where, you know, yeah, a lot of people are going to see it. Why can't you change your hair to where the hair covers the zit?
Or put on makeup. It's
instead,
so
they go to those stupid, oh my God, yeah.
Of the earth itself. This is the first zit I've ever had in my life, and the commercial's the day after tomorrow.
Don't worry, Kelly, you can hardly see it.
You mean it?
Yes, Pumpkin, trust me. No one will ever notice it.
Okay. Whoa! Look at the size of that zit! Before that baby blows, you better warn the villagers living at the base of your feet.
But don't you see that your sister's in pain? Try to be a little more sensitive. Sweetheart, that thing's not going to leak all over Daddy's shirt. Oh, I'm sorry.
I probably got this from you, you know. What else am I going to get from you? What, I'm going to wake up tomorrow and my bed's going to be wet and I can't find my jammy bottoms?
You know, if you really want to go on TV, you could draw a little face on your zit and go on Montel as Siamese twins.
Like, you could have done something with this. Like, maybe she goes to get her hair done by Emma Peel, I don't know, and she gets her hair done a horrible, horrible color, and like she's freaking out. She tries all different types of things to get it out. The pimple potion is actually decolorizing, like color go kind of thing, and like it would still have the base elements, but it would be a lot more believable.
Yeah,
like it doesn't anywhere.
And then there was another bad joke. It's kind of like Al says, honey, no one's going to notice it. She goes up, opens up the door, and someone outside yells, wow, look at the size of that zit. Before that baby blows, we better warn the villagers. Or maybe that was Bud.
No, I think you actually, so there are two jokes referring to what you, I think you're combining two jokes.
Maybe.
So there's two of them. So the first one, Al is hugging Kelly, and I remember this one made me laugh out loud. She's hugging Kelly. He's like, oh, Pumpkin, don't worry. No one's going to even notice. Literally, second after that, Bud opens the door. It just goes,
whoa! Look at the size of that zit!
The next one is when Kelly opens the door. And she's like, you know what? Maybe nobody will even notice. And I'm not going to lie, Steven, I laughed loudly at this.
Whoa, look at the zits on the blonde chick.
Comedy is all about timing. That joke landed for me. It's telegraphed so hard, but it just happened so quickly. Like,
on top of that, it's night. How could he see that? I mean, yeah,
that's the joke.
That's just, I thought it was a horrible joke. It was telegraphed, and it came off as being too canned and too corny. You know, I did like the joke when they realized they couldn't get the Emma Peel video, but they could get the Three Stooges.
Al?
Jefferson, can't you see that I'm trying to comfort my daughter here?
It's about Emma Peel.
Excuse me. What's up?
Well, they admitted that they don't have an Avengers with Emma Peel, but they did offer a substitute.
No! No deal! It's Peel or nothing!
It's the Three Stooges.
Oh, happy day! Pick two.
Now that I thought was hilarious.
That was great. And that should have been the joke from the beginning. It should have been Three Stooges. Keep it timeless. Everybody knows who the Three Stooges are. It could be them fighting over Mo, Larry, and Curly, or Shemp. Jefferson and Al are the perfect Three Stooges fans. Like, they totally could have made that work. And that joke, those jokes would have landed today as the same as they did in the 90s. The Avengers, not so much.
Yeah, because they've done Three Stooges before. I mean, not totally. Well, they do kind of act like him, but it wasn't so obvious. There's an episode, I think it's actually next season or in the 11th. Remember when they're trying to put together that bench? You know, again, Three Stooges-like moments. So Alan Jefferson have done some good stuff like that. I would have liked to have seen more of that and less of the less of just about everything else on this.
I think we've been doing a good job explaining why this episode sucks.
Aren't you going to answer that?
No. I was happy. That means it's Peg.
Hello? It's Mom. Hi, Mom. I'm so glad you called.
How's everything going, honey?
It's terrible. I've got a huge pimple. Actual Bud Bundy growing from my forehead.
Well, you know, Uncle Sticky's getting out of the pen today. You want him to make you up a batch of his pimple potion?
I thought Uncle Sticky's potion is what got him sent to prison in the first place.
It did. But I thought you were desperate.
No, I am. How soon can you get it here?
Tomorrow. Cousin Zemo is running a truckload of illegal fireworks to Peoria. I'll just have him drop it off in the morning.
Cool.
You want to talk to Grandma?
Sure. Dad! Mom's gonna send me some homemade pimple stuff.
From Uncle Sticky, sweetheart? You remember Uncle Sticky's face, honey? It's where we used to keep our keys. Now, Pumpkin, I'm afraid you're just going to have to not do this commercial.
Yeah, I mean, how much would you be losing?
$2,000.
You will do this commercial if it kills you.
Remember, honey, nothing ever good ever came out of Wanker County, and I'm including your mother. So now, here, listen. This is all the money that I've got. Go to a pharmacy and get some real medicine.
Outside? But, Dad, what if somebody sees my pimple?
Pumpkin, it's dark. No one's gonna see the pimple.
I guess you're right. I guess I'm just being silly, huh?
Whoa! Look at the zits on the blonde chick!
Thank God he didn't see the pimple, huh?
But I'm really having, you know, look, I'm still, we're halfway through this episode, and I'm like, maybe once we get to the whole commercial, we'll see some great things. Or maybe when we...
What gave me hope was when they were watching at the beginning and he was glad that Peg wasn't there to see the Home Shopping Network. And then they get a call from Waker County, Wisconsin.
So
I thought that was funny. Yeah,
that is funny. Now, but here's the problem. Waker County is so famous for the show now. Unless Katie Sagal was doing something or legit could not be here... And you need to have the episode with her in it leaving at the beginning to go to Waker County so the audience can remember and understand exactly what's happening. Or you need to have her calling more. If it's a thing that Katie Sagal can't make it on the set, well, then in post, you need to have more scenes of her calling. She needs to be more of a presence. Because
yeah.
I kind of forgot about her, which is something you should never do with Peg. She can't be a character you just forget about.
Yeah, I'm guessing she probably couldn't be there. Maybe she has some sort of commitment, but...
I did write down... Like, I love every Waker County stuff. I love it all. And it was a really, really, really funny scene between her and Kelly when she's talking about Uncle Stinky's purple... Pimple potion. Oh
God. you know what the best cure for a pimple is? You know, my dad was a doctor.
A knife.
And my mom was a nurse. And they always told me the same thing. They said, just use...
needle. God,
Neosporin.
Oh, I thought you were going to say a hot needle. And
no.
Just jam it in there.
No, Neosporin.
Hmm.
That'll clear it up within 2 days.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Huh. Okay.
For all you young Married with Children fans.
But yeah. There is a good segment, and even the good segment is still at its weakest. We have our traditional Al and Marcy fight.
You know my women's group and I are going to protest.
What?
The Stooges? If you don't like them, how come you keep getting your hair cut like Mo?
Not that, you primordial ooze. It has come to my attention that Kelly is the new ice hole beer girl. Now, you have done some low things before, but to allow your own daughter to flaunt her body to sell beer, that's low even for you. Jefferson?
She's right, Al.
Marcy, let me explain something to you. Buck, 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 buck.
Oh, that's very funny.
She's right, Al.
But unlike evolution, I am not letting you off the hook, Al. Now, can you please tell me what a woman's body has to do with selling beer?
All right. Number one, if it wasn't for beer, there'd be at least three people who probably wouldn't even be married. Me. Jefferson. And probably Lisa Marie Presley. And number two, since men buy beer, advertisers have to cater to what we want. And, hold on to your corn cob pipe, we like pretty women. Ergo, pretty women sell good products, ugly women sell tennis rackets. Pretty women cars, ugly women minivans. Pretty women make us buy beer, ugly women make us drink beer.
Yes.
And, well, it, on paper, everything works. Everything works. Absolutely, Marcy would be upset about this. Absolutely, Al and Marcy would fight about this kind of stuff. But it feels like they're just, like, the actors don't have any heart in this episode. No one's really, like, making me feel they're believing. Like, when, there are fights, even when last season, with Al and Marcy that... It gets heated. It gets real with between those two. Like, you can feel the vile between each other. And this one, it's just like they're reading their lines.
Uh-huh.
Do you get what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
But, yeah.
Because they were, like, going through... I like to use the term going through the motions.
Yes.
Because you could tell they weren't having fun. That's the thing. When you could tell the actors are having fun... Like, I thought they were having fun in season 8, Dances with Wheezy. I think you could tell they were having so much fun with that one.
Oh,
the
absolutely.
Entire cast. Yeah.
Absolutely, they were having insane fun. The Iron Haze, which me, Stephen, and Alex did a really good job with that one. But that one, we, in that episode, we did talk about, like, how a lot of that premise didn't really work out that well, but the actors sure as heck were having a lot of fun with it.
I do agree with that.
This one, it's just not.
Talking about a little bit on Marcy and Al and their interaction, and I gotta hand it to Al, and I thought this was some good writing when, you know, Marcy's upset because Al is using his daughter to... you know, sell beer, and he kind of just tells it like it is. You know, number one, if it weren't for beer, there'd be at least three people here who probably wouldn't even be married.
That's a good point. Yeah, those are some awesome owns.
Yeah.
And it's just...
Observations, yeah.
Yeah, and quite frankly, but that's a problem, though. Like, the arguments that Marcy has, and I get it, she's a super... like, aggressive, anti-sexism person. But her arguments are usually... The things that she's upset about are usually more valid. Like, yeah, it probably is a little sexist to be using, you know, girls, like, young girls to sell beer. But at the same time, that's called advertising. And Kelly's not a 15-year-old girl. She's a... adult woman at this point in the show, and if she wants to do this, It would be one thing if Al was tricking her into doing this. That would be different. If he was peddling his daughter to for beer money. That is the grittier Married with Children that I know. I would believe something like that. But no, Kelly already wants to do it, and Al's being a supportive father.
Yeah, that's one thing. I've known a couple of dads. They were a little uneasy at first, but they supported their daughters becoming Hooters girls. I will say, I thought this was kind of poignant here, because after Marcy leaves, that's when Al questions Jefferson. Hey, you know, am I wrong to use my daughter to do this?
Now, there is a line, and I have the history brought up here, but I'm also going through our transcript right now, Stephen. So Al's saying it, and it was like, I think it was somebody asked Al, name three people. He's like, it was back about from the beer conversation. Number one, if it wasn't for beer, there'd be at least three people who probably wouldn't even be married. Me, Jefferson, and Lisa Marie Presley.
Oh, yes.
I didn't get that. And anytime I'm trying to, at the very least, we can bring some historical pop culture to our listeners here. Okay, so listeners, Lisa Marie Presley, if you didn't already get it, was married to this little singer, you might have heard of him, Michael Jackson. Well, they met in 1975 when a 7-year-old Presley attended several of his concerts in Las Vegas. Now, according to a friend of Presley's, their adult friendship began in November 1992 in L.A. As child molestation accusations became public, Jackson became dependent on Lisa for emotional support. And she was concerned about his faltering health and his addiction to drugs. Lisa explained, quotes, "I believed he didn't do anything wrong, and that he was wrongly accused, and yes, I started falling for him. I wanted to save him. I felt that I could do it." Shortly afterwards, she tried to persuade Jackson to settle the allegations out of court and go into rehabilitation to recover. He subsequently did both. In January 1996, citing irreconcilable differences, Lisa Marie filed for divorce, according to legal papers. Well, where the hell does that have to do with beer? Yeah, are they trying to imply that she was drunk as hell when she met Michael?
Who knows?
And by the way, Lisa Marie Presley is daughter of Elvis Presley. I should have led with that one. But that's so weird. It's just I get Al and Jefferson. That's funny as hell. But I don't know. That was just so strange. I was hoping when I read it out loud, something would click in my head of why that joke would work, but it doesn't.
I agree with you.
Yeah, Married with Children, I was trying to help you by reading all that, and it failed.
Jefferson, you don't think I'm wrong for having Kelly do this, do you?
Well, Al, she'll probably be parading around half naked to sell cheap beer to a bunch of leering, screaming yahoos.
Oh, you're right, buddy. It's a tough call.
You want to go to the nudie bar and think about it?
Okay.
And they decide to go to the nudie bar to figure it out.
That's funny.
Yeah.
What
I also like about that is that's what gets you to think. Now, I admit, I've been to some strip bars in my life, but I haven't been to one in ages. And here's the thing for me. I stopped going when I realized a lot of these girls are almost young enough to be my daughter. And that's when I realized I don't need to be going there anymore.
Really? That's when I started going. But
are you old enough to have a daughter?
Oh, yeah, man. The average millennial was having kids at age 18 or 19. And I'm going to be 31 in a couple of weeks. So, yeah,
You could have had a daughter, but not one old enough to want to go out and do that.
It depends on the state you're in. But Just, yeah. Hey, you ever seen Raisins on South Park? Their version of Hooters? Yeah, there you go.
They try to use parody to get you to think about a little bit. You know, I think that was the genius of that old classic movie Blazing Saddles.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of racist things in there, but it's also funny, and that's what gets you to think, why am I laughing at this? I don't want to go into a huge divergent, but
no.
I think humor works a lot better to get you thinking about it as opposed to
absolutely
just preachiness.
And that's why I liked that scene where he's just like, oh, man, you're right. Should we be really perversing, encouraging a bunch of middle-aged men to be staring at women flaunting their bodies? You want to go to the nudie bar and think about it? Yeah.
Yeah.
And then they just strut out. Like, that was funny to me because that's the joke right there. And it lets the audience make up their mind if that was funny or not. And what I thought you were going to say, Stephen, is like, I've been to strip clubs before, but this is what I thought you were going to say. I don't think I've ever gone there as my thinking place.
Yeah, that's the big thing. You don't go there to think because all the blood's going to leave your brain and go to somewhere else.
Exactly. Oh, I know. Oh, my ears hurt. All the blood went to my ears, right? Oh,
yeah. It's time for No Ma'am to take a little break in the Jiggly Room. I'm the DJ, and I'm going to play a little bit of music that was on this week's episode of Married with Children.
All right, so we have this quick montage of Kelly putting on all these concealer products and stuff to try to get rid of her zit, and then you've got this Uncle Stinky's pimple potion in a Winnie the Pooh honey pot looking thing. I'm not going to lie. This was funny, but it made me want more. Like, I like that the applicator is just a huge hazardous rubber glove. And it's, like, already steaming when she opens it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Cool effect on that. I was trying to figure out how they did that. I wonder if it was, like a one of those smoke bombs that was timed to go off or something. It was pretty cool.
Hmm.
But, so, yeah, she puts on the pimple stuff, and you're left wondering, is it going to work? And then we get to where I hope, please, God, let us have some humor. And, man, does it fail. We get a new set. All right? Yeah, I think.
Well, it's probably the same set they used in
Mr. Empty Pants.
It could have been that one, but I was thinking of that one when they had the gutter cats on.
Ooh, yes.
And Kelly was, I can't think of its name all of a sudden. But anyway, you know, they probably just had that one and rearranged it a little bit. I know this set's going to be used again at least two or three more times.
And I think actually it was also used in the episode where Al's shooting, mostly this is the commercial thing going here, where Al's shooting like sports commercials and he gets punched.
Yeah.
Like it looks kind of like that. So what I'm saying is when we get to the set, I'm feeling hopeful because a lot of my favorite episodes of Married with Children are on like television fake sets where people are shooting something.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of like jokes to be had there. And man,
let me see. What part are you going to be playing? Handsome, romantic lead or Eskimo?
Take a guess.
Welcome aboard, Nanook.
Let's see, where's the...
Hi there.
You're not here for the handsome romantic lead, are you?
I don't play that at home. Look, we're running late here. Has anybody seen the Bundy babe?
Women are not babes.
I thought we nixed the sea lions for this commercial.
We heard that.
Listen, don't mind them. I keyed their pickups on the way in. I'm Al. I'm Kelly's father. She had a blemish. It made her a little nervous. And against her father's wishes, she used some stuff that was cooked up by my idiot wife's idiot relatives. And, well, there were some mild side effects. So nothing that can't be, you know, solved with the creative lighting. But, well, you guys are the experts, so why don't you tell me? Pumpkin!
When did Eskimo jokes stop being funny? Or were they ever, Steven? You're older than me. Was that a thing?
I don't know, because we have this place here in Oklahoma called Eskimo Joe's. And that's where you go get all your OSU stuff, Oklahoma State. That's the rock. We have two universities, University of Oklahoma Sooners, and then the Oklahoma State Cowboys. And
Sooners,
Stillwater's
Sooners.
Where the OSU campus is, and they have a place there called Eskimo Joe's. And they've spread out, and you can get more stuff. And actually, it was also a restaurant, too. But there was somebody was calling for it to be renamed because they thought that was racist. This was just this last year.
But yeah, like, that's a whole different kettle of fish. And yes, there are different gray areas of what's offensive and what's not. However, if you're a director of a commercial called for Ice Hole Beer, where you are going to have Inuits playing the traditional Eskimo way, and you know, people are showing up, and then this very Asian-looking person shows up and goes, well, I can see you're probably not one of the beautiful women or the handsome man thing. And he's like, what do you think? And he goes, here you go, Eskimo, and hands him this thing. Get the fuck out of my face kind of like attitude. And I'm just like, oh, okay, this guy's a piece of shit. I'm immediately supposed to hate him. This is probably going to be great. Nope. Okay. It's barely even touched upon after that. Like, he loses that complete veneer of just hinting at a racist piece of crap. Because remember, that's the one thing that Al Bundy isn't. He is not a racist, as far as we know.
Yeah.
Like, he's not. He is a sexist, he is a homophobe, and he is a all downright gross human being, but for some strange reason, he does not seem to be a person who has any problem with race.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
You know, I had to pull this up, and this is a thing by John Cleese that he wrote, came across it back during the beginning of the pandemic, and he kind of ribs at all of the different European countries. The English are feeling the pinch in relation to the recent terrorist threats and have therefore raised their security level from miffed to peeved. Soon, though, security levels may be raised yet again to irritated or even a bit cross. The English have not been a bit cross since the Blitz in 1940, when tea supplies nearly ran out. Terrorists have been recategorized from tiresome to a bloody nuisance. The last time the British issued a bloody nuisance warning level was 1558, when threatened by the Spanish Armada. The Scots have raised their threat level from pissed off to, let's get the bastards. they don't have any other levels. This is the reason they've been used on the front line of the British Army for the last 300 years.
Oh, my God. I can totally hear this in Cleese's voice, too.
I love British humor. It's so much more clever than American humor.
It's its own thing. It's completely different. I do find it funny when Americans try to replicate it, they fail.
Oh, yeah.
They
can't do it.
So, all right, we're just going to, like, I'm just going to run right through this. So, basically, the commercial's about to happen. Al comes in to introduce Kelly and is, like, prepping everybody for, you know, we had a little mishap with, the pimple stuff. And here you are, and everybody on the set, supposedly seeing what we're seeing, everyone starts at her ankles and then goes straight up.
It's looking good for a while.
Oh my God. I'm just laughing because we're seeing from her ankles up, and it's a big reveal, and everybody else in the episode reacts the same way as we should too. It's like, all right, everybody, start at her feet and nobody look at her face until we get to the top. Like, and yeah. Lo and behold, she is, we have Christina Applegate wearing a pretty good bald cap. I'm not going to lie. It's pretty damn good. And
I didn't think so.
Oh, really? I think it was a pretty good bald cap.
You can see it. There was a big, I don't know, not a crease, but an area, I think it was on her left side of her above her left eye. Well, you could tell it was off of her skin.
Okay, well, you know what? I'm going to give them a little bit of credit where I can. Like, it looked like a quick job, but it's not bad. But then she's got this very pathetic-looking goatee on, and she's just...
Buds, yeah.
Yeah, she's just standing there.
This is our spokesmodel? This? We're selling beer here, fella, not Lucky Charms. I need someone gorgeous to sell this crap.
Thank you. This should be a slam dunk multi-million-dollar discrimination lawsuit.
Discrimination suit?
Yes. I am Marcy Darcy, here on behalf of the Coalition for the Aesthetically Challenged.
Challenged? I'd say defeated, exiled, and left for dead.
You mind repeating that?
As a matter of fact, I do.
Anyway, you will use Kelly in this commercial as she is, or we will slap the biggest lawsuit on you that you have ever had.
Could they possibly do that? Sue on behalf of the ugly? How can they win that?
Four words. Attorney General Janet Reno.
And then it goes to where I was very surprised it went this way. Basically, the director says, you can't be here. Marcy's like, oh, no, you have to do that. If you don't hire her, because she's already hired. So, yeah. So that's the cool thing. There is some legal work in here. You can't fire her just because she doesn't look good. Wrong. You absolutely can. if it's a visual thing. But they kowtow to Marcy's group association for the aesthetically challenged to ugly people. And then
CAC, I guess. I thought it was.
Yeah.
I thought their group was FANG.
Association for Aesthetically Challenging. Maybe?
Okay.
It's weird.
It's the Coalition for the Aesthetically Challenged. I'm looking at that, but what I'm getting at, I thought her group was called FANG.
Oh, that's a different group. She's head of many different groups, Stephen. Like, she's evangelizing women all across the country.
Yeah, she's the feminazi, I guess you could say.
I think secretly, she was that woman from Ricola. I think she was secretly Ricola, yeah.
I never thought about that. That's a good insight there.
She's living a double life. She actually owns that home in Michigan, and she writes with a pen name. That's my fan fiction. But basically,
there was a good line on that. He said they're going to slap him with the biggest lawsuit. Could they possibly do that? So on behalf of the ugly, how can they win? Four words. Attorney General Janet Reno.
Oh, of course. Of course, Stephen. Everyone remembers the famous district attorney, Janet Wood Reno. No, I don't. And for the rest of you people who are not over the age of 40, let me read. So, Janet Wood Reno was an American lawyer who served as the Attorney General of the United States from 1993 until 2001. President Bill Clinton nominated Reno on February 11, 1993, and the Senate confirmed her in the following month. She was the first woman to serve as Attorney General and the second longest serving Attorney General in the U.S. history after William Wirt. And so basically, she's the first district attorney, meaning we have a woman here who is going to somehow intervene on a civil lawsuit, which is something the Attorney General wouldn't have any power to do in the first place.
No, she was in charge during the Waco fiasco in Ruby Ridge.
Shit, that's right.
Of course, you know, I did like her. I thought she was one of the best attorney generals we've had ever, because she didn't play politics. She took things seriously. Was it Will Ferrell who played her on Saturday Night Live skits? I think
that's who he was playing. Okay, I think you're right.
I think so. Yeah, he did it great.
When your wife looks like this, you might as well dive into an ice hole.
Ice hole beer. When it's 2 a.m. and you gotta do something.
Coming up next on Business Week in Review, the marketing geniuses behind the successful media campaign for ice hole beer.
I'm finally on my way to fame and fortune. When this beer takes off nationally and takes Kelly with it, I'll be rich.
You mean we'll be rich?
Yeah, we'll be rich. Me and Kelly. For once, and I'm not afraid to say it, Al Bundy can't lose.
Well, I was fired.
Can't win either.
What happened?
Well, once my hair grew back and the beard fell off, they said that I was too pretty to be doing beer commercials. In fact, advertisers are so afraid of good-looking people that the producers won't even touch me. Well, they'll touch me. They just won't hire me. Dad!
Dad, what are we gonna do about the money?
Well, don't worry. We'll just ugly her up. You call Uncle Sticky and tell him we need something more permanent. Sweetheart, don't worry about a thing. When we get done with your face this time, you'll be giving warthogs dry heaves.
Oh, that's so sweet, Daddy.
Okay, so basically, we've got... It's such a lazy-ass ending, because here's how it works, folks. She gets the commercial part because Marcy threatens a lawsuit, and they kowtow. Cut to Al watching TV, and then Kelly walks in and goes, I didn't get it, because after my hair grew back and the beard fell out. Oh, the beard falling out did make me laugh. Yeah. My beard fell out. Then they said I'm too pretty to be on TV. I'm so pretty that now producers won't even touch me. Oh, they will touch me, but they won't hire me.
Yeah.
Wait. Okay, so now every, like, commercial place is now hiring ugly women, and they're afraid to hire, you know, beautiful ones now? I guess we're supposed to assume that. Here's the commercial.
But it's too late. They already hired my ugly replacement.
Already? Who?
Well, see for yourself. Here's the commercial.
Hello. Remember me?
Oh my God, she's 100! And she's still kicking high!
All right.
So, Steven, they're implying that Emma Peel is in the commercial, but the commercial's sound is the intro to the Avengers British television show?
Yes. Yes, sadly.
Oh, good God. Okay, well.
And just to give you an idea, you know, and I remember he said that, oh, my God. She's 100. Well, for everyone to know, Emma Peel.
Oh, my good God. Oh, God. Listeners. This is right from the Google search page of my Chromebook. Emma Peel, this nobody that I keep trying to remember, is Marjorie... Tyrell from Game of Thrones. She's the old lady who spoiler alert to Game of Thrones, kills Joffrey by poisoning him.
Thank you for ruining that for everybody. You know, I'm kidding.
It's been out long enough, and I gave him a spoiler alert. But it's like I couldn't. Wow. So okay, you know what? Listeners, I might actually have to be watching this Avengers TV show because she's brilliant in Game of Thrones.
Okay. Actually, her name is Diana Rigg.
Oh, really? Then why did they bring up Emma Peel? Oh, good. I'm going to cut the name all
of
that
her,
crap.
I think that was the name of her character, wasn't it?
Diana.
That's what I thought. Let's see here. Yeah, she was in Game of Thrones.
She was. Okay, good.
Yeah, and let me go back here to 1961. Yeah, she was in the Avengers. Oh, I see. She wasn't a regular until 1965 to 1968.
Damn.
Yeah. And anyway, she has about 71 credits. And yeah, she was in the Game of Thrones that you were mentioning. She's done...
she's incredible.
I guess a lot of this stuff is British stuff because I'm not familiar with hardly any of this stuff.
Yeah, Steven, I just sent you a Facebook message of the picture that I found of... it's like it's showing a picture of her from the Avengers next to her as Marjorie Tyrell.
Yeah, that's a good one. And that's the way I remember, and that's the way we do remember. So they're talking about the character Emma Peel, who was played by Diana Rigg.
Oh.
And actually, it's sad. It looks like here that, hang on a second, she died on September 10th, just this last September 10th. She was 82 years old.
Oh, God. R.I.P. So it's Diana. Okay. All right. Yeah. See, that's another blow to Married with Children. I thought Emma Peel was the name of the damn actress. I didn't know that's the character. Why was he talking about her as a character? Like, oh.
I don't know. Also, she was born in 1938. This came out, in 93?
Mm-hmm.
So she's in her 60s.
Oh, that's so mean. She's only like what? She could be around Ed O'Neill. Maybe the joke Maybe the joke was that her and Ed O'Neill maybe had like the same birthday, and he's like, "Oh, she's only like what 7 years older than me, maybe at this time." Like,
who knows? But it doesn't even look like she was in the Avengers movie reboot that they tried. I was going to take a quick look at that.
And how the hell do you not bring back, like, as many people as possible, even for just a bit part? She's a parking attendant or something like that, or old lady in the bar who says hello. Like, you gotta bring back the regulars if you're gonna reboot, you know? It's like...
Yeah, okay, here we go. It has a 3.8 rating on Internet Movie Database, the Avengers movie that came out in 1998, and it doesn't look like they got... wait a minute. Patrick McEnany was in it. Sean Connery was in it. Uma Thurman, that's who played Dr. Emma Peel. But I am not seeing Miss Riggs in it. She didn't come back for it.
Huh.
But everyone said it was terrible, and so I stayed away from it. With a 3.8 on Internet Movie Database, that tells me I would not want to go see it because, you know, that's driven more by the fans. And... real quick on Rotten Tomatoes, I'll take a look on that one real quick.
Yeah, you got to stay clear of those like ones made just for the fans because, yeah, they can get a little niche that can just not. It's not
on the Avengers. The Avengers has a 5% rating on Rotten Tomatoes, and that's combined between the audience and the reviewers.
Yeah, well, so yeah, listeners, the we've talked a little bit more about the Avengers almost than Married with Children, but yeah, the Avengers, 1961 drama, 6 seasons, and I'm looking it up right now. They're all available on YouTube, iTunes, Vudu, and Amazon Prime for it seems to be only a couple bucks an episode. So, you know,
and
what? It's worth a
shot. The TV show wasn't bad. I remember watching it with my cousin and my brothers. When we were young, and we would get a kick out of it. We would then try and imitate the high kicks and everything.
It's got an 8.3% out of 8.3 out of 10 on Google Television. So, you know what?
Yeah.
It might be.
Well, like I said, the series itself was pretty good. It was that god awful movie, apparently.
Oh, true.
Yeah, and I say god awful even though I haven't seen it. But when you have a 5% on Rotten Tomatoes and a 3.4 on Internet Movie Database, that's something you want to avoid.
Oh, wow. I'm on IMDb right now, and I'm going through this show's episode titles. And this is so funny because obviously back in the 60s, they weren't thinking of people knowing the titles of episodes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we've got, these are season four episodes. The Cybernauts. The Hour That Never Was. The House, yeah. The House That Jack Built. Not the Lars von Trier horror film. The House That Jack Built.
Yeah.
Wow, okay. These are some interesting. Death's Door, The Joker, A Touch.
I do believe that was a British TV series, though.
It is, yeah.
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 So
Murdersville.
Yeah. British TV is like British cinema. It's usually a little bit more eclectic.
True.
And than American.
No, Ma'am will be right back to wrap up this week's review. Be sure to join their Facebook group page for all the podcast news and updates. Be sure to subscribe to them on the Apple Podcast app, and please leave a review telling them what you think of the show. To subscribe to their YouTube channel, just go to Channels and search up Married with Children Podcast. Join their Patreon and support your favorite podcast with a small monthly donation. You can email them at marriedwchildrenpodcast@gmail.com. Thanks for checking out this review.
Steven, how many ice hole beers are you going to chug for Kelly Breaks Out?
I would chug two ice hole beers. I don't know if that'd be enough to get me drunk to like this, but, you know.
Ah.
I'd rather have the beers and pop. I haven't had a zit since I was like 21 or something like that, so.
Well.
So two ice hole beers. I thought this was the worst one since every Bundy has his birthday.
Ooh. That's, you know what? This episode is actually better than that one. I'd rather watch that one again.
I will give you that. So maybe a little bit more, but yeah, two. I think that's the lowest rating I've given so far. Of course, we haven't gotten to enemies yet. I think that's next season.
True. Ugh. Yeah. Well, Stephen, while you're sipping on your ice hole beer, it's got to taste like piss, right? It's got to be watered down worse than natty ice like beer, right? Right? It's got to taste
definitely
terrible. Mm-hmm. Ugh. So while you're drinking...
Probably smells bad, too.
So while you're drinking that nasty beer over there, I am going to crack open five Miller High Life beers, Steven, because I'm going to need all five of them to pop this one disgusting zit off my forehead.
One, wow.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I hate it. I f-ing hated this episode. This was so, so bad. And maybe it's because we've taken a little bit of a break and we haven't done this in a couple of months. And I, in the meantime, during quarantine, I've been practicing my reviewer skills by analyzing movies and trying to see what works and what doesn't. And you shouldn't do the same thing to a television show. But coming back into this after a really good season 8, it's just, it was so sad. The plot made no sense. The fact that we couldn't understand what was really happening in certain areas for a freaking Married with Children episode, that's bad. The pop culture references were too obscure and too numerous to, and badly chosen.
Even with me growing up when I did, and being somewhat familiar with the Avengers, even I had trouble, you know, we just realized I had trouble keeping Emma Peel separate from Diana Riggs.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, they didn't even hit their demographic. So this didn't even have a sense of nostalgia for you. And you're right, like, do the Three Stooges. Pick things that are going to be, that you have a good idea that are still going to be relevant later on. And they didn't do that. The plots didn't work out very well. They didn't incorporate the characters into it at all. Nobody seemed to know what they were doing. And the acting wasn't even that good. And the dialogue wasn't good either. Nothing
You could
good.
Tell they were not having fun with this one.
In fact, the only... Exactly, 100%. They weren't having fun. That's the biggest fail. But number one biggest fail, and what should have gotten this one zit, and it's got one zit, but not for this reason, because they failed on that too. They failed on the ending. Usually, Married with Children finds a way, even in bad episodes, to end on a bump, bum, 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 kind of like moment.
Yeah.
And this one failed. The only, and this is going to sound sexist, listeners, the only thing that's given me even one zit for this episode is Christina Applegate. I do believe Christina Applegate was caring about this. I do feel like she was giving it her all. She was wearing lots of cool outfits and lots of sexy ones too.
That's the wardrobe department.
Oh yeah, like it's all the wardrobe. So you know what? The wardrobe department gets my award for this one. Like, she's looking great. And I don't normally get to see Kelly like express so many different sides visually of herself. So that was kind of cool. Usually they just have her jumping around to like, you know, like look good. This one, it's actually her trying to look good for her own reasons. So I kind of like that. And I just think Christina Applegate's a really good actress. I like her. But it's so, like, I'm barely skidding that zit out. Normally I almost left this one on my forehead. Like, ugh.
Well, at the same time, you know, for me, it was, you know, why I gave it two, aside from the two good jokes, I thought there were a few decent moments in there. It's just overall, just those few moments cannot carry such a whole show.
Yeah, we're not watching an SNL skit. We're not watching like a sketch show or something. This is that's what this felt like to me, was a sketch show. This is, and it's not. And
I am not going to be watching this one again. I mean, I'd rather watch Battlefield Earth. I'd rather watch Smokey and the Bandit 3. I'd rather watch a porno with B. Arthur and Rosie O'Donnell. Okay.
Oh man, send me that one, please. Like Battlefield Earth. Woo! Damn. Okay, listeners,
I'd rather watch those stupid Limu Emu commercials on an endless loop.
I'm pulling them up right now. I would rather watch every single sequel of Nightmare on Elm Street, Friday the 13th, and Texas Chainsaw Massacre without ever having to get to see the first ones ever again.
Okay. I hope that doesn't include Wes Craven's New Nightmare in the sequels.
Oh, it does.
Ah! you are going to smoke a turd in hell for that
one. Just joking. You know what? But thank you. I would rather rewatch the New Nightmare, the remake of Nightmare on Elm Street, with Jackie O'Hurley going full pedophile over and over and over again on loop, then watch this episode again. Man, we should have just done this. Like, figure it out. Like, keep talking, tossing out, like, what we would watch instead of this.
Oh, Tyler, I got to tell you this, too. I might get a kick out of this.
Okay.
You know, I teach kids to drive part-time, and Christmas break, so we're doing more of it. And it was just a few weeks ago, and I was talking about... with one kid, one of my hobbies is podcasting, and I help with a podcast called Married with Children Podcast. This kid knows about it. He says his dad was watching it, and
he knows about the show or knows about the podcast.
He knows about the show, at least the Married with Children show. And because his dad was a big fan, and I don't know if his dad has shown up yet as a member, but I told the kid, and he says, "Oh, I've got to tell my dad about this because he loves that show."
Oh, man. So, Steven, you are way more cavalier with your students about your podcast life. I would never in a million trillion years even give the chance that one of my students would hear me on a podcast. Because then I'm like, all right, I got to move away from the state now. Like, you'll never get the respect back.
Well, I don't know. I think it would depend on what the podcast you're doing is, because I've got another friend who hosts a podcast on history, and he makes it really relatable. He has a YouTube channel called Mr. Beat. Maybe you've heard of him, but he's really good.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, I have
heard
of
him. He does a lot of good videos. You might use that. They're great to use in the classroom, too.
Yeah, so good for him. But yeah, like, okay, history podcast where we make history fun? Awesome. Married with Children review? No. I don't want the PTA to find out about this. Like,
Well, it's not like you're reviewing, you know, Sharon Stone movies or.
Oh, yeah, that'll get you a raise.
Yeah, but, or, you know, like, you know, Dan, if I was doing like a horror podcast, but, you know, I wouldn't tell him about the horror because, you know, I think that could get you into a little hot water as opposed to a.
Oh, absolutely. It's just.
Yeah.
It's just X-ray material. And that's funny that you said that. Like, I would love to get on in with one of those April Fools reviews because I just watched that movie for the very first time and it f***ed my brain. I'm like, whoa, that does not happen to me too often with horror. But don't worry, listeners, we're not quitting our job. We're going to go forward into season 9. And I am.
Well, fortunately, the next time we get together, we're going to have a much better episode.
it can't be worse. And if it is worse, then there's something wrong with us because then I don't remember things too well. But.
Well, we are reviewing this in 2020 as well.
That is true.
The Abyss. Yeah. And I just want to remind you guys that all the listeners out there that tune in next week when the Team Australia is going to be discussing Naughty But Nice, directed by Jerry Cohen and written by David Castro. And what's going to happen is Bud is going to meet Marcy's niece.
Ooh.
And things are going to get hot.
I am so excited for that episode. I'm so jealous that they get to do that one. And we got stuck with this crap.
I was just thinking the same thing. Why couldn't we have done that one instead of Kelly Breaks Out? Oh, well.
Damn it, Australia.
I guess that's how the cookie crumbles.
Damn you, Australia. You save the movie industry, and you also get to have the best episodes. Good for you.
Well, I don't know. You and I also have Ship Happens, and I like those.
And we do have Dial V for Virgin as well. Oh, wait.
That's it. That's our next one we'll be doing.
That is
and
awesome.
We will also be hosting later on down the I think it's episode 16, Get the Dodge Out of Hell with the return of Steve Rhodes. And yes, we are going to do our best to get the great Jerry Herring to return for that episode. That's going to be a great one.
I will badger him relentlessly on Facebook until he does it.
I'm sure he will. I'm sure he will. He told me he would. In a live feed a couple of months ago or something like that.
Okay, well, that's good. One more thing I want to plug. The original Al, Alex Edwards himself, has made his own fan film of Friday the 13th, which I have yet to see because I really want to make an experience out of that. I want to rewatch the original Friday the 13th. Maybe the second one as well, back to back, and then just dive right into his fan film because no one deserves to make it better. I'm sure it's amazing. Go to the Skeleton Crew page or reach out to him directly on the Married with Children website to find out where. There's also YouTube links that we can share. It's really great. Definitely check
it's
it out.
It's on my list, and actually, I was intending on watching it on New Year's Eve. I thought that'd be the perfect time to watch it.
You know what? I might do that, too. Okay, so you know what? That's a good idea. Nice way to... I don't want this to be one of the last things I watched for 2020.
Yeah, I need to go and turn on something now, so you know, in case I die, I will not have that listed as the last thing I watch. Kelly Breaks Out.
I know. I'm going to go watch The Irishman with no subtitles for the next.
Right.
Okay, Stephen. Well, it's great to be back, and I am looking forward to this. So until
me too.
So until then.
Well, at least to better episodes.
Absolutely. Yes, I am looking forward to now that this episode is over going forward. So until next time, you guys out there in La La Land, keep being
A
Bundy. Yeah, whatever. All right. See you later.
Or don't be an ice hole.
Don't be a... Stop. I'm the host, Stephen. I get to have the last word.
Okay, then you say it.
All right. Bye. The Married with Children podcast was recorded on tape before a live studio audience.